Nature of classroom discourse. We have always studied about effective communication and how the sense of hearing and speaking improves the knowledge. So, let us see how the events in a classroom discourse will impact students' knowledge. It's very important to understand how the teachers and the students communicate in the classes. Although concepts can be elaborated and explained or shown as demonstrations, the more discussions and the ideas brainstormed, the better the student understands the concept. Even the tougher subjects can be easily understood if a teacher talks and explains it well to her students. Most of the school activities involve talking, as this motivates students to learn and excel than just by the mere reading of books. There are two viewpoints to a classroom. One viewpoint believes that communication is important in classes, and the other viewpoint states that excessive talking leads to disruption in the quality of education, hence leading to misinterpretation by students. The other distractions in class are pupils talking amongst themselves and distractions from the teacher's side or school. Here we are going to look deeply into the concept of a classroom discourse, which is a special type of discourse that is predominant in classrooms. The salient and special features of this type of a classroom discourse comprise imbalances, power relationships, speaking in turns, and various patterns of interactions. So, what is the importance of studying and understanding this concept? We shall see the answers to the questions in the upcoming topics. Concept of classroom discourse. This concept of classroom discourse has undergone various levels of interpretations to arrive at a common consensus. According to a group of researchers, classroom discourse is a different type of discourse that is predominantly found in the classroom setups. Discourse refers to the fluent oral usage of language in classrooms to convey meanings and interpretations of a concept. Many researchers have studied the concept with the help of applied linguistics and education-based research. According to another scientist, classroom discourses can be classified into four various structures, such as the IRF, initiation, response, feedback, instruction, asking questions, and finally, argumentation. The first structure of the IRF has an ancient pattern of the discourse, where generally the teachers pose a question to the students and the student responds and evaluated on the basis of the answer he or she gives. So, the three-part structure starts with the teacher questioning her students to check their knowledge, then the responses of the student to the questions, and finally, the student's answers are evaluated and feedback is given by the teachers. It is generally observed that the students' answers are usually crisp and short, and their main concern is to give accurate answers to the questions posed by the teacher. Although the important role of the teachers is to ask questions, only a few students are interested in it and respond appropriately. The instruction's mode of discourse focuses mainly on commanding and providing instructions. In this type, the teacher gives statements that contain information or directions that helps a student pursue his work in a particular pattern. This came into use because some students fail to answer verbally and they tend to comprehend statements as instructions and follow them. The questioning or probing is the next mode of discourse, where the teachers ask critical, analytic, or thinking type questions, and students are motivated to think logically and give out the answers at a slow pace. Some students who are intelligent can even challenge the teachers with witty and logical answers. In general, evaluation does not happen immediately after the answer has been given. The next mode of classroom discourse is argumentation, where the students and the teachers are a part of a challenging environment, and students or the teachers justify as to why their answers are right and accurate. In such sessions, The main types of questions are referential questions, which try to evolve predictions from the students along with logical explanations and clarifications. Such sessions usually are in questions or in forms of statements. Patterns and functions in a classroom discourse. What do you think are the common and general patterns linked to your classroom discourse? Every system has a specific pattern or a framework for it to function. In this topic, we shall discuss as to how verbal interactions play a role in the school-teacher-student relationship during classroom sessions. According to researchers and certain authors, there are two stages in the analysis of a discourse, such as distinguishing patterns in terms of variations and consistency in the data obtained and created the basic functions when people talk. However, the target of this system is beyond the emphasis of verbal and brainstorming interactions in the classroom setup. Their viewpoint of analysis is attached to traditions in the field of ethno-methodology and symbolic interactions within classrooms. Such systems and routines that are embedded in language consist various interaction patterns in the classroom setup. Let us consider an example of a teacher who feels it is compulsory to answer and clarify the queries asked by students, and this would become a routine. However, in this context, it might be considered a routine in which the teacher can pose a sequence of instruction-based questions. The questions which she already knows the answer for. At the same time, it is an obligation for the student to respond appropriately to the teacher's questions. However, this system might have a path to guessing by the student to answer the teacher's queries. Such methods have always been a routine part of classroom training and interactions. Hence, determining a pattern always involves establishing and connecting the parts and routines followed by the teachers and students. To determine the various functions of classroom discourses, we shall go through a series of experiments and systems established for this purpose. According to a few authors, texts seem to have assumed a dualistic structure. Let us consider the fact that the text can be a static link in conveying some information between the sender and the receiver. In this case, the text is considered as an information that is to be obtained, encoded, and retained. Subsequently, any disparity in the information sent and received is always linked with a breakdown in the communication channel. On the other hand, the textual material can serve as a thinking device in order to interpret the sent and received information accurately. In short, the textual material serves as the start point to structure an idea or deriving a meaning out of new ideas. This function of a text is identified as dialogic and is proved when a student in a classroom actively decodes the text and the information passed on to him by questioning, validating, or by rejecting the ideas. There are three different ways by which internalized talk can precede thinking. First is by considering language as a cognitive source. This considers that when a person or a student is given appropriate exposure, can be a fluent speaker and can participate in several ways of using a language. Second, through the method of talking, participants are familiar with alternative voices and views that can elucidate their view on the world. Third factor is the habitual patterns found in interactions. For an example, consider in a class, all the students are given an opportunity to express their views, opinions, and present justifications for the arguments or ask questions in assuming concepts. Conventional patterns of classroom talk. It is tough to generalize facts about classroom discourses since various cultures have developed in several contexts. Not only that, even the type of schools, teachers, or students vary across places, and the patterns of the talk also varies diversely. After deep research across several schools, They found similar patterns in teaching and in classroom discourses. They generally observed that the teachers were dominant in such classroom discourse interactions, communicating majorly, controlling what topics ought to be dealt in the class session, allocating turns for students to participate, judging the capacity of the students' contributions, and restricting indecent or inappropriate behavior. It's a general observation in the class that the students talk much lesser than teachers. For shorter time periods and mostly only respond to when a teacher prompts or poses a question. The entire concept of classroom discourse is composed on the initiation, response, evaluation, I or E cycles, where the teachers start new topics by asking simple and close questions that test a student's basic knowledge and recalling capacity. Usually, in such cases, the students respond in brief and crisp answers, and hence the teachers evaluate the performance and praise them accordingly. However, most of the researchers prefer the initiation response feedback chain than the initiation response evaluation chain because they believe the feedback helps in improving the candidate better. Repeated research has established that a higher number of closed than open-ended questions were posed by the teachers. In a study, the researchers had found that 50 to 60% of all the questions posed by the teachers were closed than open questions. Such closed questions generally required a factual or one-word answer or only one solution to an issue. The remaining percentage was mostly concerned with task supervision and routine in the classroom discourses. The high frequency of closed questions and the I or E system are the most widely criticized methods of being destructive to your students' independent thinking and learning enthusiasm. According to this structure, the textual material and the teacher are the lone resources of knowledge. The main role of a student is to remember and repeat what he knows for evaluation. Then the system tends to offer a discontinuous moral overall when the teacher wades through various topics without much clear reasoning. The third argument is that students are involved in more demanding critical thinking activities such as giving explanation for concepts and connecting ideas and concepts, etc. However, the majority of such work is performed by the teachers themselves and do not involve the students. Finally, the usage of appropriate and easily understandable language and the type of interaction between a student and the teachers is very significant in such discourses. However, the system of classroom in which majority of students participate and get involved in questioning sessions are not useful for progress in the learning and does not improve the students' knowledge. Such methods do not encourage students to learn and discourages their thinking skills. This, in due course, restricts their potential range of logical reasoning and textual authority. So, what do you think can be done to modify or improve the educational system? We shall see in the newer efforts to improve studying and in the further topics. Dialogic alternatives. As we had seen in the previous sections, how the traditional classroom discourses worked, but later they found a lot of lacuna in the system and hence decided to modify the existing techniques. Here in this topic, we shall discuss how and what was the transformation that happened in the traditional classroom techniques. Researchers and famous educators from wide range of fields and disciplines of education had recommended newer and improved methods in classrooms. Dialogue is a common term used in such classroom discourses and is one of the preferred modes. This dialogue can span across various disciplines and is an integral part of every classroom discussion. The several approaches to dialogue differs on basis of their basic aims, whether they are education or social, or the various angles to a talk, or to whom are they intended. In the following classes, we shall see five of the most important dimensions, such as the structural, epistemic, interpersonal, substantive, and political. The structural dimension of the dialogic model was aimed to substitute the IRE model, which had the domination of the teachers over the students, with a system where the students can freely exchange their ideas and concepts and discuss their rights. This system ensures that their voices are equally acknowledged. The next epistemic dimension deals with a more critical angle towards knowledge acquisition. In this viewpoint, the students and the teachers will have an active participation in understanding the meaning of what is being said in the classes, and are expected to contribute in every class discussion, unlike the traditional methods. They are expected to aim and focus at the questions and open to genuine queries. The third dimension is the interpersonal dimension, in which it seeks to establish a supportive and a collaborative community for education and learning, instead of focusing on individualistic impersonal environment. Such environments are predominantly identified in the traditional classrooms. The fourth dimension is the substantive dimension, that seeks to substitute the commonly disconnected nature of the traditional classroom discourses, in which the teacher or professor takes the class through a series of redundant and unrelated IRE cycles to discussions that are usually known as the dialogic teaching. In this, both the teachers and the students understand and build their own concept of ideas and link them coherently to establish a meaning. The final dimension is the political dimension, which seeks methods to give students maximum agency, voice, and participation in terms of classroom etiquettes. This system strengthens the deprived groups and converts schools to places where students learn and acquire knowledge and the basic skills to survive in a critical democratic environment. Considering all the dimensions discussed in terms of social interactions in the learning environment, we can conclude that a healthy discussion and mixture of ideas from students and the teachers is necessary in today's world. Such systems do not completely deprive a teacher of his or her rights, but encourages students to think independently and improve their analytical and logical skills. However, these ideas suggest that a teacher's classroom discourse practices are interlinked to the social dynamics present in a classroom. The role of classroom talk in student learning. In the previous sections, we had seen how the traditional classroom in discourses functioned and how various modifications were brought in to improve the learning process. In this section, we shall study about the importance of talking while educating students. Talking is considered an integral part of a teacher's job, while she teaches and engages the students in her class. According to most researchers and educators, talking can be classified into three types of classroom talk, such as rote, that refers to mechanical repetition of facts, ideas, and concepts by teachers in classes. The term recitation describes a knowledge accumulation and thorough understanding of questions to analyze the student's prior knowledge or to apply them appropriately to arrive at an accurate answer. Finally, the instructions or the exposition method refers to the concerns that tell the students what to do and divulges information by elaborating the basic facts, principles involved in a concept. However, some teachers and educators use their other kinds of classroom talking patterns, which have higher cognitive potential, such as discussion and scaffolded dialogue. The discussion type generally is observed in a teacher's group, teacher class, or between two students. This refers to the rapid exchange of ideas in sharing information and by providing solutions for problems. The concept of scaffolded dialogue refers to obtain common and a good understanding through a methodical and cumulative questioning and discussion method that will guide a student to appropriate learning. This method reduces the risk and error and increases the quality of learning. However, the method of using scaffolded dialogue is more complex and it needs more teacher skills, but still it remains less common in methods of classroom teaching. According to a popular study, the role of several talks are condensed to the concept of scaffolding as follows: the rote talk does not scaffold. Basic recitation offers bleak chances, yet a well-designed instruction and well-planned discussion can aid to scaffold effectively. According to another researcher, there are differences between the two functions of talk, presentational and exploratory. The former talk deals with the needs of a teacher over her students. This case of talking usually is observed when the teachers are trying to get answers from the pupils to assess their understanding of a topic taught previously. On the other hand, the concept of exploratory talk encourages the students to experiment and evaluate new ideas, to perceive what others make of them, to portray ideas in a different manner. In general, these types of talks cannot be isolated in classrooms. Hence, teachers might use them in a combination to convey the lessons to students. The presentational type of talking displays the function of talking according to the IRE sequence. Talk is usually exploratory when it is organized in a dialogue form. The quality of classroom talks is based on several factors, such as whether they are closed or credible questions, the IRE system, how the classroom is organized, how the students and teachers communicate, size of the classroom and its culture. The type of questions may vary from culture to culture. For example, consider both the teacher and the learner to be from India. Both generally tend to prefer closed questions to higher order thinking questions. While concluding, I would like to say, from the already discussed topics, we shall now summarize the concepts. The quality of the education and the learning a student gets is proportional to the quality of the classroom training. Hence, as teachers, we should attribute more significance to the spoken form of communication during classroom sessions. We should always remember to be consultants and not be mere information transmitters. Teachers should keep in mind to encourage group-based discussions and also allow students to be free in generating their own ideas and questions to explore answers. Also, traditional system-based questions should be framed in such a way to support thoughtful answers and improve student response. In addition to all these methods, tasks involving oral skills are to be given greater importance than the traditional tasks such as writing and basic spoken skills. We, as teachers, should ensure we are updated on our teaching skills and make our classes as interactive as possible to draw all the students' attention. We also have seen about the five dimensions of dialogic alternatives and where they are to be applied. We had also seen the types and the effects of the three types of classroom talking and the usage of presentation and exploratory talks. From this session, we can conclude that the quality of education imparted by teachers is entirely dependent on them, and to improve a student's education, the teaching system has to be modified. Thank you.